Good evening.
Good evening.
Once again, just a few words before we get started here tonight. To those of you that are joining us for the very first time, and to those of you that this is either a second or possibly a third time, and obviously to the many more at home joining us via live stream, we welcome you and we thank you for making a conscious effort to join us here tonight. As I mentioned last week, we had 91 homes actually our first week join us remotely. Last week we were able to top 100 homes, so we're very excited to be able to offer that. It's wonderful that we can offer that in that way, and we welcome all of those that are here today and at home. On behalf of the entire St. Bernard's staff and our planning team, we are very grateful for the opportunity to present to you Strength Through the Journey, our 2021 Lenten Experience, or communal trip together from Lent to Easter Sunday. And again, we truly felt this was an appropriate theme for this series because we have all experienced something in the last year as we have journeyed or navigated our lives. On your way in, you may have noticed our floor banner that is sitting over the by the baptismal font, and it's been there ever since the series started. It's also on your worship aid, but because the size of the banner that is out there, it's much more visible. If you haven't already, please, we invite you to take a look at it as you leave today. The depiction is a road, a dirt road, leading up to a cross, our cross, our cross. As I said, we have all experienced something on this journey. Your road might have a few more curves in it. Maybe your road is just a bit dustier. Maybe you have a few more bumps in it. Maybe yours is a bit steeper leading up to that cross. But in the end, it leads to the very same point for all of us. So we make this journey beyond our weekend liturgy together with the hope to calm it with some reflection, with music, with scripture, with prayer, even silence, as we journey as a faith community. Father Tom McCarthy steered us in our first week recounting St. Joseph's role in the early life of Jesus leading up to that cross. And last week, Deacon Sam Jutris gave us our bearings as he reflected on the role of the Eucharist as it plays as we travel that road, how Jesus does not want us to make that trip alone, but to be united with him, to actually be carried with him to our destination. And now tonight, we have the unique opportunity to experience a very powerful commodity that is rarer and even more elusive in our ever-bustling lives. Quiet and stillness. So, because we are also, again, still in the midst of our pandemic, we remind you that it is not yet wise to sing at full strength. However, we do know that it is very important to your experience here tonight and much more meaningful, so we again have provided you with all of our song lyrics in front of you in the worship aid. So please tonight join in singing those songs in your heart, in your mind, reading along, or singing lightly behind your masks. Please stand.
Thank you.
Let us all pray together the prayer for strength and guidance. Lord, I reach out to you for your guidance. Please show me which way to turn. Calm my anxious thoughts. Come speak into my mind. Strengthen me as I falter and feel weary. May I feel strength rising up within my heart. Bring clarity into my visions and dreams. I trust that you are with me, no matter where I go or what I decide to do. Your journey with me always. Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from the book of Psalms for Praying, An Invitation to Wholeness by Nancy Merrill. Psalm 132. Enter into the silence, into the heart of truth. For herein lies the great mystery, where life is ever unfolding. Herein the divine plan is made known. The plan all are invited. Listen for the music of the spheres in the resounding silence of the universe. May balance and harmony be your aim as you are drawn into the heart of love. Those who follow the way of love with calm and faith-filled intent know that all is working toward healing and wholeness. And may the healing power of love lift you from the limitations of fear and ignorance into the arms of freedom. May the peace of the Spirit bless you and lead you on life's journey. Be not afraid of the silence, for wisdom's voice is heard there. As you follow the light, you become gentle and kind. You come to live in the light and see through love's eyes. Children enter the world radiating with spirit. Learn from them of innocence and simplicity. Learn to cooperate with the unseen realms to see beyond the veil. Wise are those who learn through silence. Learn then to listen well. For beyond the silence and stillness within, you come to know a profound and dazzling silence. Herein lies the music of the spheres, the harmony of creation. Enter into the sacred altar within. Converse with the beloved in sweet communion. Blessings of the great silence be with you as you help to rebuild the heart of the world with love.
Come to the quiet. This evening we are pleased to welcome Sister Carol Mucha, a Mercy sister who recently retired from her work at St. Xavier University in campus ministry. She was a former teacher and principal in the Chicago Archdiocese as well as Laredo, Texas. Sister Carol also was a Chicago Archdiocese education consultant for 7 years vocation minister for the Sisters of Mercy for 9 years, and ministered in parish as spiritual coordinator working with youth and young people, young adults. In addition, Sister Carol has presented retreats to religious communities, prepared prayer rituals, guided college students preparing for the sacraments of reconciliation, Eucharist, and confirmation. She presented at parish missions and provided creative approaches to prayer and spiritual formation. And if you want to see the rest of these wonderful things that she did, she's very highly educated. She spent her time at several of the wonderful universities here in the greater Chicago area. And Sister Carol is certified in the art of spiritual direction. Sister, all the spiritual directors I've had since I became a deacon 18 years ago have all been sisters, because that way I get the good stuff. So we welcome Sister Carol Mucha to our evening, to our parish, and you're always welcome to come back. God bless.
That was quite an introduction. So good evening, and blessings on all of you as you continue this mission, striving to find strength for the journey in these pandemic and chaotic times. This evening, you are invited to come to the quiet to be renewed and refreshed for whatever lies ahead in your individual and our collective lives. It is only in the stillness that we can be sustained by our God, who awaits patiently for times such as this, but also hopefully in the everyday circumstances of our lives. And that contact with God can best be made in prayer, or an awareness of God's ever presence in our lives. It has always been so, is now, and ever shall be, because we have been born of love, who is God. The great Saint Teresa of Avila wrote of prayer in these simple words. She said, prayer is a close sharing between friends. It is taking time to be alone with God, who we know loves us and awaits our response in return, so that we can love back. We seek God, whether we consciously are aware of it or not, because to desire Him is always the beginning of love. And we seek God in pure faith, which causes a deeper relationship. If we are faithful in prayer, we live in God, and God lives in us. In seeking, in praying, we begin to understand the why and the how of our Christian life in order to adhere and respond to what God asks of us in our daily lives. It is a way of maintaining the fruits of great love and also of great suffering over the long haul. And who of us has not experienced great love and suffering in our lives? So in seeking, we begin to understand the why and the how of our Christian life in order to adhere and respond to what God asks of us in our everyday lives. We are helped then by staying attentive to what is difficult to sustain as we attend to the many demands on us in our families, in our communities, in our church, and in our world. And those demands and stresses have grown today astronomically. There are, however, many assists and resources we can gather to help us to stay faithful to our prayer. We know there are books, primarily sacred scripture, the Gospels, liturgical writings of the saints, spiritual fathers of the church, writings of our Pope, who's been writing lot lately. Contemporary spiritual writers, theologians, and even poets. In the quiet, prayer ought to involve our imaginations, thoughts, dreams, hopes, and desires, all of which are gifts of God. And all of these can deepen our faith conviction, can prompt our conversation and our conversion of heart, where conversion is needed, our step away from sinfulness. Such fidelity to prayer can strengthen our will to follow Christ as he has taught through his words and examples that we find in Scripture. In silent contemplative moments, however, which are the simplest expressions of the mystery of prayer, we become aware of the union of ourselves with our Trinitarian God in the depths of our souls. This is where God purifies our vision so we can really pierce reality and know a loving awareness of the God who lives within us and we in God. In stillness, we gaze in faith and our face fixed on Jesus. It is a time of renunciation of ourselves. We begin then to see everything in the light of truth and God's compassion for us and all of humanity. Our gaze is then turned on the mysteries of the life of Jesus and how we might live to love and follow as true disciples more closely. Sit with God as a friend, delighting in his presence without even needing any words. We desire to know him better and understand his desire for us to bring us to fullness of life. This realization has so much to do with how we live every day, with all the challenges that we face. It prepares us to deal with great love and great suffering when they arrive at our doors. Otherwise, we face the task of life on our own small and momentary feelings and defenses, which are always inadequate to the tasks of greatness. We can nurture openness and presence ahead of time, so that when the opportunity comes, we are ready and willing to accept with God's grace that which faces us. And it will no longer frighten us or strand us in helplessness. We will recall God's words that we read in scriptures. For example, in Isaiah, we read, "The Lord comforts his people and shows mercy to his afflicted." Again, we read in Isaiah, "The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and those who are crushed in spirit." In Hebrews, Paul's writing to the Hebrews, we read, "I will never forget or abandon you." And in the Psalms, we read, "Let your heart take comfort." And finally, a familiar phrase you will recall from Matthew's Gospel, "Come to me, all you who are weary, and find life burdensome, and I will refresh you." All of these are found in Scripture to enlighten us and to lift our spirits, and all to enable us to carry on after reflecting in the quiet on what these statements have to do with my life situation. So in preparing for this evening, I brought my request to the Holy Spirit in my prayer, asking that I might know what God wanted me to communicate to you, how I could be an instrument through which my words would really be God's words. I struggled for several days, waiting for an answer. And then it was on February 18th, in my prayer, I found the answer. The message I heard was this: just share your experiences of what praying in this stillness meant during this 11-month pandemic. What insights did you learn? What inspirations came to you? How did you grow closer to me? How did your faith deepen? What did you learn about yourself? What helped you to become a better carer? How much more do you love me? So, my dear people, I have the answer, and I have prepared to share with you what I captured in my own times, in my journals, and what actions I have taken to put into practice the many insights God so generously shared with me through these many months in my own prayer. So let me begin with some examples. One of the first inspirations I had was to realize that my God, to whom I pray, is both a healer and a miracle worker. So what healings did I experience in this past year, almost year? My brother is now cancer-free after months of chemotherapy. My niece had a growth in her lung that diminished and did not spread. My friend had a fright about what she thought would be a serious medical condition, and it proved to be nothing. For myself, I was able to escape COVID and get both vaccinations, as were all of my eligible family members. Some are still working on that, and the Sisters of Mercy with whom I live. This is what my healing God did. And so I learned that I can count on this God. As for my miracle working God, I was able to have a heartfelt conversation with my brother in Arizona in July when he died peacefully. He called each of us family members from his hospital room and his dying bed for one last, "I love you, Carol," just days before he died. And his wife was just diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. And with her, the miracle is her beautiful positive acceptance of her pending death. She speaks of the beauty of her life with my brother, who just died 8 months ago. Another miracle is learning from her about how I should prepare for my own death. Then there is the miracle, a simple one, of my car starting in the coldest of weather when I needed it. So you see that miracles come in small ways and large ones too. And sometimes we miss the obvious, and we fail to identify our God's involvement in our lives. But in stillness and quiet, these actions on our behalf by God and his compassion for us becomes obvious. Another insight I had during one of my contemplative prayer moments called me to create in my imagination two bowls as I pray each morning. One I labeled my blessing bowl, and the other my begging bowl. Each morning I imagine the bowl before me beginning with all the many blessings, the answers to my prayers, the ordinary gifts that before I may have taken for granted. So I might pray in thanks for the breath of life, in forgiving me, my God, forgiving me my sins, for the gifts of his sacraments, my church, my vocation, my education, my formation, and all the people who contributed to who I am today. I place in my blessing bowl my family. I recognize the gift of their care and love. I place in my blessing bowl things that I never thought about before, such as electricity and water, technology and food, shelter, sleep, clothing, for anything or persons that blessed my day the day before. I see this blessing bowl as overflowing always. And I realize that there would be nothing in that bowl were it not first given to me by God. So I'm just returning it all back to God, I hope, with my own contributions to its fullness. Then I turn to my begging bowl each day, which becomes as full, if even not more so, than my blessing bowl. Here is where I ask for an end to this pandemic. Across the world, I ask for wisdom and knowledge for the scientists working on all of our behalf. I beg for safety for our police, our doctors, our nurses, our essential laborers, for our Pope, the bishops, for priests, for people suffering from illness, from COVID, for an end to the abuse of children, racism, human trafficking, and for the homeless and the hungry, the leaders of our country, world leaders. I ask for a change of heart for those who need to turn toward God and away from evil. I always beg for world peace, first in my own heart, and I always make sure I do not ask anything or very little for myself, except to grow closer to God. I ask for deeper faith and a desire to grow more deeply in love with God. And finally, I was inspired to consider having my blessing bowl and my begging bowl taken to the Trinitarian God. So I looked at the saints, and it came to me that I have a guardian angel who I named Hope when I was in high school by the encouragement of my religion teacher. And all of the favorite saints, I looked to them, taken from my name, Carol from Charles, so St. Charles, from Anne, my middle name, Joan of Arc, my confirmation name, Jacinta, the name I was given in religious life, John of God, the school where I grew up and learned my faith, John of the Cross, whose day, feast day, I was born on, Francis and Augustine, favorite saints of mine, Catherine and Angela, and last but not least, I ask the Blessed Mother. So I ask all of these saints to take my oaths to God on my behalf. And one of the insights I had while I prayed one day was that all of these saints represent so many diverse cultures. Among them, Augustine from Africa. You know, among them, Joan of Arc from France, Jacinta from Portugal. And so I realized they were representative of a diversity of cultures, which gave me great joy. Then in a recent retreat, as I sat in the quiet home one, I thought about the Sacred Heart, and I realized that if you transpose C and the A in the word sacred, it would read scared heart. So I began to draw a picture of a heart, and over the word sacred I wrote, "My heart is sacred because its source is God. Its destiny is to God. It has an indomitable spirit, healing ability, loving capacity, always emanating hope." Over the word scared, I wrote, of telling, I'm afraid of telling my own truth sometimes. Maybe of not being loved enough, not accepted, facing the anger of others, offending, not loving enough, and failing God. Then I looked at that word again and I added another R, and this time scared became scarred. And over the word scarred, I drew scars on the heart. And I wrote, "Why is my heart scarred? From the ravages of spiritual warfare, from emotional and physical pain through time, from isolation, from misunderstanding, from the loss of those I love." And so my heart became scarred. And finally, I was prompted to write, "This heart needs to become whole and holy." And God can do that. God as friend, trusted companion, nurturer, and through prayer. Because solitude means holiness. One other time, I read the scripture passage in which Jesus said, "I am who I am." You may have recalled that. And what I heard said to me was, "Carol, be who you are." So I reflected on why did those words come to mind. And I realized that perhaps I was not satisfied with who I was. Or maybe I was trying to become like someone else. And soon that began to change, and I will never forget those words. I knew what I am being called to do and to be. In another reflection, I realized that I am being prompted by the Holy Spirit to do things that I was deciding for myself. I was in control of how I did things, what I would do at any given time, but I soon became aware that it was really the Holy Spirit who was prompting me to do things, which I now call not prompting but poking me, to do something, to go somewhere, to be with someone. It was not I who was in control, but the Spirit of God. And so in my blessing bowl, I will usually thank for the pokings of the Holy Spirit, and especially for those pokes that I have said yes and would do. That is truly a blessing, and I know then I cannot make a mistake. On another occasion during my prayer, I was brought to a realization that for too long I was hanging on to hurts that others through my life had caused me. Those stood out, and time after time, I kept revisiting the pain associated with those persons. So I knew they probably were not aware of the hurt that they inflicted on me, but that I was holding on to the baggage. So again, I knew that I would need to do something about it. And so in my prayer, I decided to take six persons in my prayer for 6 days, one for each day. I prayed that God would allow me to free myself and them from this burden. And at the conclusion of the 6 days, I felt so free that this line came to me, "Love like you have never been hurt." This mantra not only freed me at that time, but I continue to live by that. When anytime someone causes me pain, I cannot tell you what good has come to me from that experience in my prayer. Peace, anyone can do anything to me, but peace will settle in where anger and stress took hold of my soul. And you won't believe this, but one day I was, I think it was Kohl's or Target, and I was looking at different things for my wall, and guess what I found? I found an actual ceramic piece that is now hanging in my living room, and it says these very words, "Love like you have never been hurt." The exact words that came to me in prayer. So as this Lent arrived, I was prompted to pray about how to make this time spiritually fruitful. So I came up with a plan, asking God to keep me faithful to it. So what came up in my prayer was Mondays. Mondays would be meatless as a way of fasting for those who are hungry. Tuesdays would keep me busy with phone calls to persons alone, right, folks? Wednesdays would be an only liquid fast day. Thursdays would be my letter writing day to people from my past who live far away or maybe not so far in this pandemic time. Friday would be a personal retreat day for me, more time in prayer, reading scripture. And Saturday is a tough one for me because I am addicted to news. And so I do not put the TV on Saturdays. And Sunday's a day off. And so it allows me to eat the sweets that I didn't eat all the other days. All of this came to me in prayer. And one day, as I sat in the quiet, waiting for God's message for the day, I recalled the morning scripture of that day. And it was from Matthew's Gospel. And it said, "Whoever will not receive you or listen to your words, go outside that house or town and shake the dust from your feet." And for some time, I was carrying some guilt about leaving ministries and people I came to know and care about because of circumstances that were difficult and challenging with some persons. I always knew that I had to leave that particular ministry, but there was always that edge of wondering in myself whether I was running away from something or someone and abandoning those who I was called to serve. There were six such occasions, I recalled, as I prayed that morning. And these were big decisions of leaving these places. One was leaving Laredo. But always I knew they were in my heart, they were the right decisions. And now, that morning, I realized I did what Jesus suggested and advised the disciples to do. Shake the dust off your feet and go on. What a great comforting image for me that I did not need to feel guilty. I thank God for awakening me to that understanding. And how many times have I heard that passage? And this time, for the first time in the quiet, I was alerted to what it meant in my life. I prayed a thank you to God. In reading my journal of this year, I found that one day in my prayer, I heard God asking me this: "What do you see?" And this is what came to me. "I seek much of what I believe the world and all of us seek, peace." And I wrote, as St. Francis once said, "It begins with me." So how am I to begin? And what came to me is, pray for it. But don't stop there. Live it wherever I am and with whomever I interact day after day. Begin in small ways. Pray for the virtues that you need so that they would become stepping stones to peace. And those are forgiveness, patience, kindness, compassion, self-giving. My seeking has come through examining my day to see how I have done. Where have I failed? What are my sins of omission? In this way, I come to know myself better and see the growth taking place toward becoming a person of peace, gradually unfolding in the journey of life, the process of growth toward God. And I must remember that God is always seeking me on behalf of those in need. Another morning, in the stillness of prayer, I realized God was very present to me, and I was feeling physically well. I realized that for too long, I have taken for granted my being well and being able to do so many things. So I began to pray and thank God. I began to thank God for my eyes that could see and pry and learn, remember and open and close and enjoy the beauty of creation. I could read and look and notice detail, and I could see Christ in the eyes of others. And then I prayed in thanksgiving for my ears that could hear and listen and sense, enjoy music, my friends' sharings. And I moved to my hands that could touch, feel, hug, work, write, type, hold, carry, wash, drive, bake, eat, feed others, serve, and receive the precious body and blood of Jesus. And they could pray, my hands could pray. Feet that could walk and run and stand still, dance before, much better before than now, skate and swim, jump and skip, stoop, bend to reach, and kneel to pray. My mouth that could smile, speak, sing, shout, pray, praise, chew, praise God with others. And then, thanks for my head that could bow, that could question, that could learn, that could dream, that could wonder, that could remember, however deficient now. Recall, solve problems, plan, and hold memories. And shoulders that could carry burdens and give children rides before arthritis set in. I thank God for the wonder of my body, wonderfully made, internal organs that could love, process food, provide nutrition, keep me whole and healthy to do God's work, spread God's word. I pray to reverence my body and use it as God intended when he lovingly and cleverly created me in his own image and likeness. One morning, my prayer went to berating myself for the fact that every morning I do a myriad number of little tasks, chores around the house. I eat breakfast, and then, finally then, I turn to God in prayer for a longer period of quiet prayer, sitting and reading the scripture of the day along with other prayer books that I use. But then I asked God, why are you so patient with me, waiting for me to pray, to listen to you and to converse with you? And I got an answer from God, and he said, because I love you. Then I said, but there are a number of people who love me, but they lose their patience with me. And there are many who I love and whom I lose patience. Why not you, I asked. The answer, because I am God. Now my prayer could be peaceful, and so each day I follow the same routine. God waits for me, always. As the year moved on, I reflected on so many things that had broken in my life. So one morning, I looked at what they were. The laundry door, my knees, the car, the TV, the relationship with my brother who died in Arizona, and the relationship with a grade and high school friend who had dementia and died on my birthday. My own diminishing health and that of my niece, another brother, a friend. And in those breaking, I needed God more than ever. So I pondered, what did I learn from all these happenings? And in the stillness, this is what came through my tears. Some things can be fixed, but some not. Some things take a long time to fix, some a shorter time. All things require help from others to be fixed. I can't do it alone. In the end, all will be well, as it should be. I learned a better understanding of others, of extending compassion and kindness when others suffer brokenness. And now, my friends, I think these are sufficient sharings of my experiences of what happens when we are faithful to prayer and when we sit in the quiet. Of course, I understand that many of you are not as free as I am, now that I'm retired, and I know in terms of time to do that for you. Nevertheless, giving something to God, whether it is during this mission, or on a retreat, or even a few minutes in your day, it will make a difference in your life as it has in mine. When our eyes are closed in death, we want to have reached a spiritual maturity capable of grasping the meaning of suffering, of challenges in our lives, and see them really as opportunities that taught us wisdom that God was always ready to offer us, but we didn't give him a chance because we did not make time for him to speak to us, to guide us, and to love us. Now, as I conclude my own sharings of what happened in the quiet of my life, and you are given this time to engage with God, allowing him to love you and to speak to you in the time provided, I would like to end with a poem by a great spiritual writer. Some of you may have heard and read of him. He is Henry Nouwen, who was our contemporary and died a few years ago. And this is what Henry said. Dear God, speak gently in my silence. When the loud outer noises of my surroundings and the loud inner noises of my fears keep pulling me away from you, help me to trust that you are still there, even when I am unable to hear you. Give me ears to listen to your still, small voice saying, come to me, you who are burdened, and I will give you rest, for I am gentle and humble of heart. Let that loving voice be my guide. Amen. So now, I wish you peace as you meet the God of your heart in the quiet times of your lives, the one who loves you more than you can ask or imagine. And I hope that you experience many pokes of the Holy Spirit this evening and many evenings, so that you will have strength for the journey, for the years that await you.
Thank you.
Responses, saving God, hear our prayer. For people hungering for a knowledge of God, we pray to the Lord. Saving God, hear our prayer. For people searching for meaning in their lives, we pray to the Lord. Saving God, hear our prayer. For people who experience personal doubt and confusion, we pray to the Lord. Saving God, for people experiencing personal darkness and God seems to be far away, we pray to the Lord. Saving God. For our world, that it may accept an invitation to be with God in the midst of chaos, we pray to the Lord. Saving God. For peace in our hearts, as we come to fall more deeply in love with God, we pray to the Lord. Saving God. For ourselves and our families, that we may always know the presence of God, who is always awaiting solitude and prayer, we pray to the Lord. Saving God.
Once again, if we can please thank Sister Carol for being here with us tonight. Thank you so much for helping us to continue shaping our Lenten experience. And to all that are gathered here tonight, to the 50 families that we have joining us at home, thank you for being inquisitive and curious enough to carve out a piece of your precious time to be here. That is something that we never want to take for granted, so we do thank you for making this a truly communal event for us here tonight. You are 3 weeks in, and you have 3 weeks to go until that final destination of the resurrection on Easter Sunday. Have you challenged yourself? Have you tripped or even fallen down on that path in Lent 2021? As I asked last week, does your map look the same as the one that you pulled out on Ash Wednesday? How about a perspective? How about a perspective on using inner strength to help chart your course for the second half of Lent? Next Tuesday, March 16th, we will be honored by parishioner Miss Corinne Cirillo, and she will open up before us on her perspective of finding your inner strength and what it has taken her to navigate all that has been thrown at us, something I think that we can all very much relate to and look forward to in this very unique witness. So please do remember that our reservation system will open on the parish website on Thursday morning at 9 a.m. It will close next Tuesday, the day of the event, at 4 p.m. And if you use the reservation hotline to make your reservations, you can do that as well if you need assistance. So at this time, we welcome you to the quiet. Those who wish to stay for the next 30 minutes or so and pray and reflect are welcome to do so, or you may leave any time that you wish. We do ask that if you do leave, please do so respectfully and maintain a spirit of reverent silence for those remaining. And again, thank you all very much for being here tonight, and please enjoy the rest of your evening.